You have to let the body take over. You have to let the senses take over. You have to let the gut brain take over. So if you are looking at the way your heart feels, the information hits here first, and then you analyze it, you've actually just disassociated from it. The best thing for you to do is to feel first and then think about it after, if you're gonna think. So in this video, I would like to talk about why people get stuck with releasing, why they can't releasing, revealing. There's a number of main reasons why people get really stuck. I still get stuck and I have to do something about it. As we go deeper into the subconscious mind, we start releasing at a deeper level, you're gonna get stuck because the ego is gonna try to stop you from moving forward. You're moving into emotions and feelings and sensations that you're working on letting go of. That's what releasing is and revealing is. It's letting go of deep repressed thoughts and emotions. And when you go to let go of stuff that's been put away for a reason, I liken it to being put away into Pandora's box. The body wants to fight it. It wants to stop you from getting the release, okay? Or it wants to trick you or do something. So there's a lot of reasons we put stuff away, you know? Maybe you're a child, and this is a really common reason, and you had a really stressful childhood. Maybe one of your parents was really hard on you, and you had no way to process all those emotions. Maybe it was anger. In my case, there was a lot of anger in the household, and there was no way to process those emotions. One of the defense mechanisms of the human body is numbness, apathy, to numb out, like feel all this pain. You can't go through your whole life feeling it, and since you can't get rid of it because you're still living in the environment, the body then begins to numb out the feeling. And that's a really good defense mechanism for a while. But as you get older and you get into a situation where it's time to let all that go, well, you've had that put away for years for a reason. I want to let it go. And so the ego, the subconscious mind, it will hold on to it, will resist the release, okay? So what we have to do is really look at the revealing process from the form of the welcoming, allowing, observing part of it. There's the letting go part of it is great. And that's why I like the term revealing, because we don't have to let the whole thing go. We can just kind of reveal a little more information until it's ready to be released. We can keep doing a reveal into a deeper understanding of what I'm experiencing here and get a deeper awareness, deeper insights until I'm ready for release. Because awareness, whatever you shine the light of consciousness on, has to eventually create a release. If you keep increasing your consciousness or growth in that area, if you keep increasing your consciousness in any given area, your reveals to the ultimate release of the feeling is inevitable. Even if you only go 1% at a time, or 1/100th of a percent, or 1/1000th of a percent, it's gonna compound into an eventual release, okay? So let's look at this a little deeper. What are the reasons that we get stuck? And I've got four that I wanna cover today. One is thinking. A lot of guys are really addicted to thinking. I was super addicted to thinking. I was a thinking machine. I spent all my time in my head. I couldn't feel my body, had no relationship to my body, and I had to develop a relationship to what my body felt like. When I first started to develop that relationship, I developed more of a thinking relationship to my body. And so I wasn't really developing a relationship to my body. In other words, if I was gonna feel my heart, I thought about feeling my heart. I would focus from my analytical mind on what my heart feel like, trying to collect all the right information to get it perfect. And that's not feeling. That's creating a layer between you and actual feeling. And that layer is the thinking layer to the feeling, and then going down and analyzing the feeling. That's not real feeling. If I'm on a surfboard, snowboard, skis, martial arts, doesn't matter what it is, and I'm thinking about the next move, I'm thinking about how to adjust to that wave, I'm thinking about how to block that punch, what's the odds are it's gonna work? I'm gonna fall off that board, I'm gonna get hit. That's the way it is. You have to have muscle memory to do that. You have to let the body take over. You have to let the senses take over. You have to let the gut brain take over. There's a gut in your brain. It's called Gut as a Second Brain. You can look it up on YouTube. And there's lots of books written on it. That's your instinctual brain. That's your instincts and your senses come through there first. And then you go up and analyze them. OK, Okay, so if you are looking at the way your heart feels, the information hits here first, and then you analyze it, you actually just disassociate it from it. The best thing for you to do is to feel first and then think about it after, if you're gonna think. This is what meditation helps to teach. Let's stop that thinking mind a bit. Even if it's running in the background, that's fine. What we wanna do is take consciousness. Imagine consciousness as a separate energy from thinking. Thinking is powered by consciousness, but so is feeling. Everything is powered by consciousness, like electricity goes where you direct it, right? So if we take that consciousness and take it out of thinking and allow ourselves to just experience the environment through pure feeling, that's very different than if I think about feeling my heart. Another example of this is if I massage my hand, I can sit there and analyze and think about how that feels. I can study every little movement, and that's what we do. We over-hyper, it's called the law of relativity, we get too focused. I sit there and focus. And in that, I don't really get the full benefits of the massage. Now, the other way is I do the massage and I don't focus on the hand. I relax and I take in the whole environment. I take in everything. I hear the little hum in the background. I hear the plane flying overhead. There's a plane in the distance. You probably can't hear it on the mic. I take in, and then I notice in the whole environment, the experience of my hand and what it feels like. It's like I'm letting it come to me versus me chasing it. Hopefully that makes sense. In the past, I would use my thinking to say, what do I do with that? Now I relax and I just let the experience come to my consciousness, wherever you consider your consciousness to be. And that creates a very different sensation. And you got to start to do that with the whole body. Let's say I go out and I talk to 5 girls today and I flirt and I joke and I flow and I screw some stuff up and I do some things right. But what I don't do is in the moment analyze it. I don't think. I just go out and I play and I do the game and I do the dance and I get back and then later I sit there and analyze everything I did and how I could do it better in the next time. That way I've had the visceral experience first and then I analyze later. Let's liken that to something else. Maybe it's surfing. I get on that surfboard, or I'll say snowboard because I love snowboarding, and I'll get on that snowboard and I'll ride and I'm not going to analyze every movement. I surrender and flow and adjust and keep flowing. And then, you know, maybe I fall down. That's the muscle memory figuring it out, and the gut brain figuring it out. And I get back up, do it again. But then afterwards I can look back and analyze what happened, whether I'm looking at a tape or my memory. And I say, okay, I can do this better, do that better, do this better. Because hindsight is 20/20, and you can learn a lot from hindsight. But if you try to analyze beforehand, you actually cut off some of that energy from going down to the senses where the real information is and where you learn. I remember I was snowboarding many years ago. Gosh, must have been 20 years ago or more. And I was really frustrated with this hill and that I was going down, and I was falling a lot. And I was tired, I was cold, I was hungry, and I was hurt, but I just wouldn't give up. And I was kept falling and falling and falling. And I think I fell right next to this, was I with her? I was with a girl on that trip. I don't remember if she was right there or not. My ego might have got triggered right here. And I was just tired. And at that point, I remember this flush, and this brings me to another reason we don't release, of energy that came through my body. And that flush of energy was like, fuck it, I don't care anymore, I'm gonna do this. And I got a little tense, and I was like, okay, this is gonna happen. And I stopped thinking. My focus, my frontal lobe turned on. I got so focused on the mountain in front of me that I was killing it. I was like, pop, 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 and I was in flow state. And I was like, this is awesome. And I was really enjoying it. I was like, this is amazing. I was so happy. And then I looked around and realized what I was doing, started thinking about it again, like I've been doing. And I, of course, fell down. But I was really happy with that run, that little bit of the run where I really kicked on. That's how I more snowboard now. That's how I more handle all of life. But at the moment, I was like, what was that? What was that? And if you ever studied the frontal lobe of the brain, you understand that the side of the brain deals in fear, doubt, worry, and the frontal lobe deals in focus, and that's going to happen. And then it works in time with the gut brain to create flow states. So in releasing and in revealing, when you go to do these reveals, if you're stuck, stop trying to think about it. Practice just feeling and feeling and feeling all of it, relaxing into it and saying, I'm going to take, maybe you take 2 days, a day, a week to just practice. I've given the students an assignment just to practice welcoming, allowing, and feeling their body-based experience for a week or a month. It's a form of moving meditation. When you walk, I used to do it when I was really stuck in apathy. I'd go for a walk every morning in the apathy. I just welcome it, feel it, and feel it. I stopped trying to get rid of it because I'd rather do the revealing process at that point where I'm just welcoming and letting it reveal. Like they would change. The quality of the apathy would change. The quality of the feeling would change with each reveal. Reveal a little bit more to me. Show me a little more. And I wasn't trying to get releases, although they would happen. But I was getting a deeper sense of surrender to the feeling. Then at the end of that week, all these emotions started rising. I was able to begin releasing again and revealing and releasing even deeper. Bigger reveals to deep releases. And so that's the first one, is really understand that you got to get beneath the thinking. And it's the same thing. The second one is numbness. And we just started to talk about that apathy and numbness. And I can't feel anything. And that's a sign that your nervous system, you should always be feeling something, peace, flow, joy, courage, happiness at the highest levels, and lower levels, anger and pride, and lower levels, apathy, grief, and fear. And so if apathy is numbness, it's nothingness. So if you're feeling nothingness, you're feeling the lowest level of energy. I don't feel anything. There's nothing here. I've heard that so many times from clients, and I have felt that way too. So I know that I've overloaded the circuit breaker is flipped and shut off feeling. That's that overload of feeling is apathy. So that's when I'll spend a week, 2 weeks, just welcoming all the numbness till it starts, the circuit breaker resets itself. Sometimes it just happens in a day, but if it's something's been with you for 30 years, you might have to welcome for a while, just be with it until emotions start coming back up. And then there might be crying, there might be sadness, there might be loneliness. The biggest problem is the rushing of releases. And so that brings me to the next thing, is that you want it too bad. A lot of people want, need, have to, are chasing, trying to get that next release. And what happens is they're not present again with their bodies. That's another form of thinking where they're in the future, I'm going to get this release, I'm going to get this release, rather than in the now, where the numbness is, or the heaviness is, or the pain is, or the loneliness is, or even the joy and the courage, because you might be scared of feeling really good. And that happens too. And so letting go of all that wanting, there might be up here where wanting feels tends to feel a little better. Like I'm up there, I'm wanting to do it. I'm going to make it happen. This is going to happen. I'm going to get these releases. I'm going to do it. And there's a sense of charge in it. But then you just get more frustrated. And if you drop the wanting, what's under it? Suddenly you're sad. You feel the apathy. You feel the numbness. You feel the grief. You feel the loneliness. And so again, getting under that wanting is where the money is, because that's sad. All those emotions are why you're wanting so bad. You're trying not to feel those. So you drop all that, feel all the emotions underneath, and then you start to welcome all of that. And then what do you replace wanting with? If you're not going to want and you're feeling all these heavy emotions and it's time to climb out, it's anger. It's pride, it's courage. This is the middle three emotions. This is brings me to my fourth reason people have trouble releasing. They're scared to feel their anger. They're afraid they're gonna get reactive to it and lose control. And that's a real potential problem. But if you start practicing welcoming 1% of your anger at a time and learning to be proactive with it, that's your intensity, your power returning. And the scale goes apathy, grief, fear, lust, anger, pride, courage, acceptance, love, peace, right? So that apathy, grief, fear, so much of the world is comfortable with that. Nothingness, sadness, crying, loneliness, grief. And then on the weekends, we go into some happiness by state pumping up and drinking some beers. But that anger, pride, and courage, anger and pride, especially lusting anger and pride, wanting anger and pride, that level, we kind of get ashamed of. And we tell our buddies, oh, she's hot. We say, I'm so mad at this person and behind the back. We don't tell people we're mad at them. We're afraid of our intensity. We don't. And pride is all about win-lose. I'm going to kick your ass. I'm going to beat you, man. You're not going to. And so there's cockiness in that. And so for the average nice guy that's stuck down low, those are bad emotions. You're not supposed to feel stuff like that. You're not supposed to get competitive with people. You're not supposed to beat people, you know? And so learning to feel those emotions and stop making them right or wrong, good or bad, is really important for getting ultimately up to courage, acceptance, love, peace. Remember, anger, pride, and courage are all intense. There's a thin line between anger, pride, and courage. Courage is intense too, and anger is intense. Anger is lashing out, wanting to attack, but courage is win-win. We can all do this. And so if you can feel your anger and welcome it back, and you could feel all that part of yourself that is angry at the world or angry at your mom or angry at your dad, and you can start to own that. Say, I'm fucking angry. I got a lot of resentment. I got a lot of push down. I got a lot of, and resentment's the key. We resent. Resentment is this smoldering, repressed anger that's been there most likely for years. And the building up of resentment ultimately shuts down tons of emotion and destroys relationships and connection. So the more you can start to own that resentment and start to welcome it, even just a little bit at a time, the faster you can climb out of the apathy, grief, and fear. Because now, as I start to climb out of the apathy, grief, and fear, and I feel anger, and I'm like, oh, shouldn't feel anger, and I push it down, that's a no emotion, I actually force myself back into the apathy, grief, and fear, and I cycle between the two. I can't. Or I start to feel pride, oh, I shouldn't be prideful, that's wrong, and I push myself back down, guilt and shame, and I never climb out. Now imagine I feel the anger, and I'm like, ooh, I feel angry right now. I'm gonna stay proactive with this anger. I'm gonna ride it a little bit like a wave. I'm gonna learn to feel it, not lose control to it. And then there's a sense of pride that comes, you know what, I did that. I handled that anger. I didn't lose control to it. I was pissed. I told the person I was pissed. I welcomed my anger. I said, I'm pissed at that. I'm pissed at my mom for years ago. You know, I talked about it with a friend. I got it out and then I released on it and it was great. Now I feel proud of myself. Now, how can I turn that to a win-win? Well, there's a sense of I'm proud of myself. I won. I did this. But then the win-win is I feel so much lighter around mom now. It's a win-win for both of us. And you can start to see that difference. Or my girlfriend, same thing. The death of almost every relationship is resentment. Like I'm mad at her and I don't tell her and I keep putting it away in a little box, locking it up because I don't want to rock the boat. And eventually that all builds up and creates a disconnection, a wall between you and the other person. Eventually the relationship falls apart. So if you look through your life, how many people do you have all this anger and resentment towards? Let's not even say anger. It could be annoyance that you put away. That's a form of resentment. Judgment you put away. That's a form of resentment. Just a resentment in general. These stuffed away, heavy. It's almost like an apathetic anger. We keep pushing it away. And that all needs to be brought out and released. You can bring it out and you can. One of the ways you can do that is you can imagine somebody in front of you that is that person. Have a conversation with them. Tell them exactly what you feel. And keep letting go of the guilt of saying what you want to say. Like, I resent you for this. I'm mad at you for this. You might even find that at certain points you say, I appreciate you for this. And I love you for that. Because the resentment lets go. You can start to care about this person again. And so going through that process with an imaginary person, a surrogate, a person that can handle it, you can say this stuff to. And ultimately, as you get more control and get more comfortable, having real conversations with real people about how you feel. And one of the best ways to learn to do that is there's a book called Radical Honesty. This will help you with your releasing. Read the chapter on anger and relationships and just really take that in, because he really teaches you to deal with the anger and pride and geez, you know, these and the repressed resentment. But the key is don't just have the conversation, release and let it all go till your heart opens and you feel this openness again and you start to laugh. And that'll pull you out of the apathy from fear, because your power will be returning. Remember, when you go out and you get your energy repressed, you typically feel anger first. Like you're feeling free, you're feeling courageous, you're feeling peaceful, but then somebody says something to you and you get angry. And then when you get angry and then you get squashed down even more, maybe as a child, because you don't have any power as a child and your parent yells at you even more, eventually you go into maybe some fear. And then eventually you go into, you can't do anything with it because you're just a little kid and you're stuck in this household and you go into numbness. So the anger is your pathway back out. You feel the apathy, grief, and fear. You feel the anger gives you the energy to climb back out. And what'll happen is if you get reactive to that anger and lose control, you'll probably go back down. But if you get proactive with that anger and really learn to say, I can handle it, I'm a man, I can handle my anger, my intensity, my power as a man, which makes me so damn sexy, it starts to move towards courage. You get proud and then courage, and then eventually you can go into acceptance and you can be this calm, centered, powerful man. So these are the reasons your releasing stops working. Overthinking, numbness, which is basically apathy, wanting, needing, chasing, having to, got to, that whole category of being in the future, trying to force it, And that's another form that causes more thinking. It actually moves you into these spins, like this racing mind. And then being afraid of your anger and your pride. And as you get into relationship with these, and you ask yourself whenever you're stuck, which one of these am I doing? Or am I doing a combination? Probably some combinations, never black and white. And these aren't set in stone. You're going to find you're going to get out much easier. When you're really low on the emotional scale too, down in, you know, apathy especially, sometimes it takes a while. You got to sit there and just do reveals for a while. That's why I call it revealing. You got to sit there and just reveal. Show me more. Show me more. Just teach me until it finally opens, and then you can go back to just letting go completely. And that's a beautiful thing. Nothing wrong with that. I've had to do it many times. I've given students the assignment of that. And that's a powerful, powerful, powerful process for going free. So hopefully you enjoyed this. Hopefully you're getting value out of it. I love doing these videos and I love helping you guys out. And what I'm gonna ask you to do is, if you got value out of this, to make sure to like the video, because it helps us, you know, helps us to grow the channel, to create more powerful content for you like this. Make sure to subscribe if you haven't subscribed. That also helps the channel. I get the feeling we aren't being seen by a lot of new people based on the growth of our channel lately. A lot of new people aren't seeing it. So, you know, your subscription helps to make sure you see the videos and they don't disappear in your feed. And then the other thing is to share the videos, because if we're not being seen by a lot of new people, sharing really helps. If you think somebody could benefit from this, to share with them. Also, put a comment in the video. Let us know what you really liked about this video, what you want more of, because we really check these comments out and we figure out new videos from those comments. With that said, I'll see you in the next video. And remember, only the confident really live. Take care. Have a beautiful day.